thanks for your attendance tonight. I really appreciate it. It was 12 months ago, almost to the day, that I stood here and announced a maiden drilling, our first effort to get the holes into the ground, had made a discovery. And of course, we announced at that point that we'd found an unusual ore body, if you like, an unusual target. And at that time, we were a little bit uncertain as to what that meant in terms of size. We weren't certain about size, how do we value this project? And I'm pleased to say now, 12 months later, in just 12 months, that we can come back and I'm going to give you some detail on, and try and answer some of those questions tonight. Just a snapshot for those who don't know the story. So the project we're going to talk today about is this project. It's called Pitfield. It's about a 3-hour drive, 300 kilometres north of Perth in Western Australia. It's a giant mineral system within a sedimentary basin. It's formed by a hydrothermal fluid that's come up into the basin. It's 40 kilometres long, 8 kilometres wide, and we've actually mapped this thing about 5 kilometres deep into the basin itself. So, it is truly a giant system that we've identified. We've drilled it. We've drilled a lot of holes. I'll talk about that shortly. And it's full of this titanium mineralization. Titanium as a product is extremely important commodity. It's a critical metal. It's a fantastic market to be in. We talk a little bit about where we're located. Of course, as you know, we're one of the best mining jurisdictions in the world, being in Western Australia. It's a fantastic place to operate. Great board, great management, really putting together a really strong technical team. I'll talk a little bit about that. I think really the importance of this slide was to say the last bit. What are we trying to do? Because 12 months ago we didn't know. But really in that period, this transformation of the company into a focused titanium dioxide producer. So what we want to do is go to a stage where we can be from mine to product, single stage, fully integrated, quite simple processing steps, high value. And we'll explain that also in a little bit more detail. So what is titanium dioxide to start with? I think 12 months ago, again, we were sitting here and people were asking that question, and it's a product that's been around for about 100 years. And when you think about it, what's it been used for? Well, pretty well everything in your daily life. So not so much in England possibly, but sunburn cream, I use that a lot down under. It's reflective, it repels ultraviolet light. So now what it's getting used for is window coatings for cooling and energy efficiency. It is the single most brightest and whitest of all the pigments, and there is no substitute. And what does that actually then transform to? Well, most of the market for titanium is in the pigment industry. So you're looking at roughly 89% of all titanium in the world goes into making pigments. Pigments that go into paints, coating. Pigments that goes into plastics or paper transformation. So it's their everyday use. What's really critical about it, though, is the titanium that goes into metal. So a titanium metal has twice the strength of steel and half the weight. So every time you fly and you land, you've got to thank titanium for that. Now, there's lots of other uses, but one of the ones that have been really growing is in the defence industries, and this is why I think it's now classified as a critical metal. Certainly the US are trying to secure supply, and most of the supply comes out of Russia, so you work out the geopolitical risk of that. Why do we say it's a giant? Well, we mentioned the size. I don't think people comprehend this in any real sense, but this is like taking, and I've said it before, it's like taking Mount Everest, turning it upside down and shoving it into the ground, because that's how big this thing is when you look at it on a three-dimensional scale. We've drilled down 400 metres. We've drilled over 108 holes, and we've drilled over 30 kilometres of the strike length. Every hole, surface to the end of the hole, is in mineralisation. Every metre of every hole is in mineralisation. There has been no ore body I've ever seen in my entire career that is a consistent and pervasive of this. It's just the nature of how this thing formed. It is literally a freak, and it's the most impressive titanium discovery on the planet. To give that some scale, I can finally come back. After this drilling, we can finally put numbers on this. So we've got between 28 and 32 at the moment billion tons at roughly 4.5 to 5% TiO2 in situ. That's 1.5 billion tons of titanium dioxide. So I'll just pause it. 1.5 billion tons of titanium dioxide, to give you perspective. The world consumes 10 million tonne per annum. This would supply the entire world for 150 years. It also only represents about 20% of the area that we should be looking at. It's only 20% of that big target. And we also cut it at 150 metres because that's how deep majority of our drilling was done to. So this is just a dipping your toe in the water of this thing. I think the important thing to raise here, though, is we're not going out and drilling for more. I'm not going to waste the money we have extending the ore body along multi-generational supply. What we are now looking for is understanding what type of minerals and what is their value. And we announced a couple of weeks ago that in the weathered cap, the surface cap that covers this entire ore body, is full of titanium dioxide minerals. It's full of rutile type group metals. And the importance of that I'll explain in a little while. But if you move forward, if you look at a section through the ore body, it's simplified in this image. Basically, the top 40 metres has been weathered, just naturally weathered by exposure to sun, rain, the normal conditions. You know, Australia is heavily oxidised surface caps. And what's happened due to that weathering is the minerals that we found in the bedrock, the fresher rock, have already been altered. It's a really important point. Natural alteration of these minerals has converted them to titanium dioxide. And what that means is these minerals that we have in this ore body are not refractory. They're not difficult to process. It just naturally will evolve if you give it long enough. Now, I don't have that time and patience, so I'm going to have to speed that up in the processing route. But in the top 10 to 20 metres, it's already been done. So the focus now for us is how do we extract the most value out of this discovery? And obviously the starting point is to go and look at how we get the first top 40 metres and how we separate it. So I mentioned some of those numbers. I mentioned that we had, roughly 1.5 billion tonnes in the total system under the current exploration target. In that weathered cap, there's 4 to 5 billion tonnes. And that runs at a slightly higher grade due to the weathering. So there's something like 240, 250 million tonnes of TiO2 just sitting there at surface, in what is basically soil, saprolites, clays, free digging, no overburden, no drill, no blasting, easy to access. That represents the real value of this particular project in the near future. I'm going to step back for a second now and talk a little bit about where this thing's going to go. So basically, the titanium industry, There's sort of two aspects to that in terms of supply, but it's all ilmenite. The majority of titanium metal and pigment comes from the mineral ilmenite, which is an iron titanium oxide. It's either a hard rock ilmenite, which is what Rio mine in Canada, the Norwegians mine, and they have to smelt it to get a product. Or it's beach sand, what you guys would probably be more familiar with, the mineral sands that you mine off the beaches or the old beaches. Now, all of those products still have to go through a very intense refining process to make pigment. There's no free tickets. There's no cheap and cheerful answer to making titanium pigment or metal. What we want to focus on is how do we get our product out of our ground, this naturally oxidizing mineral, how do we get that and extract it and sell it to the high end of the market? So the circle there, the chloride high-grade market, is where we're targeting. And the importance of that is typically they'll pay up to about $2,000 a tonne for that product, where if you're making an ilmenite concentrate, you're lucky to get $300 a tonne. So the uplift in value for getting up into the higher grade product range is extremely important for this particular project as well. How do we get there? Well, as I said, the sort of minerals that we've now encountered within this ore body that have formed through this hydrometallurgical processing in nature are not refractory. They're not difficult to process, and they're not difficult to convert to TiO2. And when we do, we'll be making a high-grade TiO2 product, you know, somewhere in the order of plus 95%. So this is why we think this project is really suited to a fully integrated single-stage process at one site. No intermediate products, no shipping across the world and selling into a low-grade or a low-value supply chain. There's also a potential, given the quality of this material, that we could look to make metal. And when you start making titanium metal, then you really are starting to sell into the highest value end. So that's the option, that's the value proposition, if you like, that this project offers. Why do we see that as the, this is the opportunity? Why is the timing so important? Why is this where we want to take the company? Well, for simple reasons. At the moment, the Chinese market is starting to become more dominant. They move from being like, I think, sixth or seventh on the list of titanium producers to number one in the last maybe 10 years. They make low-grade titanium pigments out of low-grade magnetite-rich ore. Generally, they have byproducts. What that has done is put pressure on the Western supply. Western supply is suffering from a high cost base now. All of their processing is high energy. There's low availability of high-grade stocks. Sierra Rutile was one of the major suppliers of high-grade rutile to this industry, and their stocks are declining now. That sort of typical reserve high-grade resource has been diminishing over the last few years. So where do we fit in? Well, we're going to come back into that market. We're going to look at mining those natural high-grade rutile ores at the surface. And we're going to start trying to provide an alternative to what is obviously a market scarcity. Infrastructure and services. Now, unlike many new mining ventures that are emerging, we have no problems with our own access to infrastructure. We have no problems in terms of tenure. We have no problems in terms of mining license, the right to get out there and mine. So what we're sitting on right now is licenses that sit within farmland. We're dealing with the landowners, and this is wheat belt. So basically it's a compensation for a wheat field that we have to deal with. There's no natural fauna, no natural flora that we have to be concerned about. It's already been basically a paddock for the last 100 years or so. We've got rail lines running right through the system, connecting all the way to a major port in the Midwest, the Port of Geraldton. It's 150 kilometres away, connected by port. High voltage lines cross our licence. There's a gas pipeline running 30 kilometres to the west of the licence. And they're now building a hydrogen hub, because that's actually an oil and gas field in its own right near Dongara, which is the small port just to the west of the license. So infrastructure is already in place. It doesn't require any investment. Currently, what we're trying to do, and our focus, as I mentioned earlier, is to move away you know, move away from grassroots exploration. I don't want to put rigs out there and just keep extending the target. We'll come back and infill, and we'll do some further drilling to get metallurgical samples, and we'll advance this now to a JORC-compliant mineral resource pretty quickly. But the real focus in the next 6 months is pin down a processing steps that we're going to need to put in place to separate out those titanium minerals, and then look at how we process them into a final pigment stage. So we've linked up with several big institutions in Australia. One of the ones that are really important to us is CSIRO. This one, CSIRO, it's the federal government scientific research centre, and it was set up decades ago in Australia for scientific research, but its mandate and focus is actually on commercialisation of these technologies. So what we've done is collaborating with them, looking at how they will provide certainly a lot of the science that we need to bring this whole project together. Curtin University, which is a university within Perth, is part of the West Australian School of Mines. So it's a mining, and you know, if you like, a geological mining university. And they are collaborating with us now on the geological development side of this ore body. You know, why did it form? How did it form? Won't go into huge detail. This presentation is going to be circulated, so we have put some details behind the steps we're taking. Excuse me. H124, it's now June. We've finished everything that we promised in the last 6 months. We've done the exploration target. We've put together the exploration team. We've pulled together the mineral assemblage. We know what we're dealing with now. The next phase, the next 6 months, resource drill out. I'm going to get the process design, test work done. And in 2025, the idea is to move to a development plant, to a demonstration plant, if you like, rather than a commercial plant. But the idea is to prove not only that we can process the ore and produce a high-grade product, but to take that product out to the market and start finding market, you know, start trying to get marketing offtake agreements. I mentioned the strength of the board. It's a small board. A few of them are here tonight. Greg is here, the financial director. Arabella, our business development manager. But effectively, it's a very focused on trying to get this project into development and add some value. The technical team I mentioned, really pleased with what we've been able to bring to bear on the project to date. We've got a couple of people internally that have worked on very complex projects, but also several industry, titanium industry consultants, a couple of them I've known for a very long period of time and I know their expertise. So happy to talk about those later, but I think it's fair to say we've put together a pretty impressive technical squad. Corporately, majority of our shares are traded by the big retails at the moment. They're basically a lot of retail. We don't have a lot of institutional investment. That's something that we're working on. We're probably at the last 12 months been a little bit small for institutions, but we're now getting on their radar. So that's starting to shift. There's been a couple of big cornerstone investors come in the last 6 months. And in summary, basically it's the speed. I think probably the word accelerating doesn't quite give it justice. In 12 months, from maiden discovery to producing the world's largest exploration number on any titanium project has been a pretty whirlwind effort. So we're now focused on moving away from being an exploration play to a development play. We are focused on a fully integrated solution to this. So we're not going to make concentrates. We're not going to go out and compete against ilmenite producers. We're going to go straight for the, you know, if you like, for the throat. We're going to try and get as high up the value chain as we can and start making something that's equivalent, you know, to a TiO2 final product. The extensive weathering cap that we discovered and announced a few weeks ago, as I said, it really is the game changer. It proves that the ores that we have are quite amenable to processing, but but it also says that if we can separate those, get them into market, the processing has already been done. It is TiO2. So in a nutshell, big industry, location is world class, great team, and I hope in the next 6 months that we'll be back with the processing routes mapped out.
Thank you, Shaun. Okay, so uncharacteristically, no flippant first question from me. Straight over to you. So who?
Hi, Shaun. Have you any doubts that a commercial processing steps will not be developed? Do you believe 100% that they will be developed?
Okay, so the question, what I'm doubtful about is my time frame. The outcome, I've got no doubt that we will find the solutions. And I can say that with a lot of confidence because, you know, the mineral system we're working with, the titanium minerals are naturally different from the gang minerals. You know, you're talking about heavy minerals versus quartz and silicates. You're talking about minerals that are either magnetic or non-magnetic. You're talking about minerals that will separate by flotation and other chemical processes. So the separation techniques, there's nothing unique. It's just about finding the one that most effectively works and coming up with an economic, you know, concentration path. I've set an objective for 6 months. But, you know, that assumes that certain things just fall into place. If it's 7 months or 8 months, then I'm sorry, but we'll get there. But I'm certain we will come up with a solution.
Other questions for Shaun? I'm just coming down here now. I'm just wondering how far down the development curve you'll get before you're offered a ridiculous amount of money to buy the company and what that value would be as it stands now, bearing in mind it's a $24 billion industry.
Yeah, what we have to understand about this, I think straight up, and I've said this multiple times, is that we are different. We're different from everybody else in the industry. And a lot of people at the moment regard difference as being either negative or high risk or, impossible almost has been thrown at me. But the reality is different just means we've got a unique ore body that has unique minerals of a scale and grade that has never been seen before. So once we tap in, like we said, and solve the separation steps and we start to show people we can extract the metal, then I think they're going to come. But whilst we haven't solved that, you know, haven't cracked that nut, they're all looking back going, nah, it's too different. So I think our difference is actually, you know, it's holding our share price back, there's no doubt about that, but it's also allowing us to get far down the value add chain before we pop up again and says, hey, we've sold it, now we're worth X.
Any thoughts of an ASX listing?
Yes, there is thoughts of an ASX listing. We've constantly, and not just ASX, look, it's an Australian-based project. Australian investors get this sort of stuff, I think, probably a little bit better than what's happening here in the London market at the moment. It's a little bit, again, because we're different, but they will understand that this is going to be a game changer. But there's a lot of money and time invested in getting a listing away, and I would rather spend it on solving in the next 6 months that problem. Take your money and work out, I think, where we get the biggest uplift, and that is coming back in 6 months saying, nailed it, this is how we're going to do it, this is what we're going to achieve. And I think, I've got to think about where I spend the shareholders' money.
Add a little bit more colour about the collaborations with the technical colleges and the scientific institutions that you referenced there.
Yeah, certainly. Look, we'll start with Curtin University. So Curtin University is a big, massive, you know, it's probably the third or fourth ranked geological university in the world. possibly higher than that. And so we went and saw them and asked them if they'd ever seen an ore body like this. And they said no, and by the way, can we study it? So we did a deal where they put at least one or two of their senior professors, a sedimentologist, they're doing dating of the titanium. You know, that's already started. There's postdocs working on it. They pay for half of that. We pay for the other half. So from a scientific research point of view, I mean, the information we'll get out of that is invaluable, and we'll never find, you know, technical people with that sort of skill set, you know, in the private sector. The CSIRO, the Commonwealth Scientific Research Centre, as I said, their mandate, and it doesn't, it's just not mining, it's in research around all of, you know, scientific research around Australia, is to identify new industry, do the the development of that technology with the view that it would be commercialized in Australia. So they hold the intellectual property, but they give us in return an exclusive, you know, the right to apply it. They don't, you know, there's no restriction. And that works in our favour because the last 10 years they've been working on a titanium processing route to extract titanium out of magnetite ore, which is really difficult. And the two or three scientists that are doing that are now working on this. And I don't think this is going to be anywhere near the challenge, but they already come with the IP. And it's just transferable.
Very quickly, because
it's a follow-up question, Shaun. Does that mean we can take it that the Western Australia government maybe, or other parties may do something to help?
The federal,
aid or things? They've already given you some.
Yeah, the federal government, it'll come from federal grant. So most people understand probably that Australia is a Commonwealth, you know, it's a federation of states. The states have certain investment budgets, but I can tell you the federal government's the one that we want to tap into. They have something called the Foreign Export Development Board, and their purpose is to find and encourage Australian industry to the point where you make something and you obviously export it for the benefit of the Australian economy. That's the same group that gave Iluka $1.2 billion to build a rare earth plant. That rare earth plant is about 60 kilometres south. I'm just going to go back, sorry. So I'm going to go back to my map. So that rare earth plant is just below us. That's where $1.2 billion has just been invested, as I said. And it's not an equity investment. It's a basically a no debt loan. It's a no interest loan.
So finally, can anybody guess what sport it is that Shaun plays?
It's not chess.
Don't you help them.
Australian rules.
Australian rules.
At my age?
Yeah. Mr. Jenkins, what do you think? What sport do you think he plays?
I haven't got a clue.
You haven't got a clue?
I won't be surprised that he's an athlete.
Yes, he is an athlete. Right, one more guess. Bruce, what do you think he does? You've gone all very bashful. Well, I'm not going to tell you. He'll tell you over drinks. Okay. Right?
I don't drink. I'm an athlete.
Okay, thank you, Shaun.
Thank you.
Well done.